Hi, I'm Lydia Hallie, and I created this JavaScript quiz course to have a fun and interactive way to teach you all about the fundamentals of JavaScript. In this course, I'll prompt you 50 questions about topics like the event loop, scopes and closures, the this keyword, classes and prototypes, garbage collection, and so much more. So get ready to test your foundational JavaScript knowledge and have fun at the same time.
So then we have the very first question to put the logs in the correct order. So we have the promise resolve, the then callback, queue microtasks, set timeout, a regular console log, a new promise constructor, and then the async function. So it's up to you to put these in the correct order, how you think that they'll be logged. And then afterward, we'll see if you have it right. All right, so the correct order would be 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3. So first, let's just see what happens when we execute this script. So the very first thing is that we call promise.resolve. And this just gets added to the call stack because it's a regular invocation. And it's an immediately resolved promise. So the then callback is, or the then function, it's pushed to the call stack right away, which then schedules that micro task because it's the callback to the then chain method that was, as we just saw, that is a micro task. Then we call queue microtask. So that queue microtask is added to the call stack, but that then schedules that microtask, which is the console log 2. Then we have the set timeout, gets added to the call stack, and that schedules the callback in the web API, which on the next tick gets pushed to the regular task queue. And at the same time, console log 4 is pushed to the call stack. This is just a regular function, so 4 is logged as the very first value. Then on the next line, we have the new promise constructor. And the body of new promise is just executed synchronously. And that can be a bit counterintuitive because a lot of people think that the new promise constructor body is also run asynchronously. That's not the case. It's only like that the resolve will execute the rest asynchronously. But yeah, this is just pushed to the call stack, which then logs 5. So the second log is 5. And then we have the immediately invoked async function. And again, also here, that body is just run synchronously. It's only the like awaited value where the asynchronous part kind of begins. We'll also look at that in just a second. But this is just the first thing. So console log 6 as 6 gets logged to the console. So now the call stack is empty. So the first thing that happens is that the microtask queue gets checked. And the first task there gets added to the call stack. So the callback for the then method, so call or console log 1 gets logged, and the same for 2, which was that queue microtask callback. So the next one is 2. And then there's nothing in the microtask queue. There was something in the task queue. So that thing is pushed to the call stack and logs 3. But we can use classes and we can also extend classes. So in this case, you know, we have an animal class and we can create a mammal. It's still an animal, so we still want to have some of these properties. In this case, name, like all animals have names, all mammals have names, but mammals can breathe. Unlike, that's not all animals. Yeah, we have a canine. Well, canines extend mammal because they can breathe, but then they can also howl. So like wolves and dogs. And then we have dogs, which extends canine, but they can actually wag their tail, which I just learned yesterday that not all canines do. It's just dogs and wolves, I guess. But anyway, we can make it more specific every time. Now, of course, when we create a class, there is something to remember is that all the properties in constructor are specific to that instance, and everything not on the constructor is added to the prototype. So in this case, we have dog 1 and dog 2, and we create a new instance of dog. And we have name and breed on the constructor, so they all get added to that instance, so they all take up memory. We have name and breed, like Max and Labrador, and then we have Spot and Dalmatian. But bark and wagtail are all defined on the prototype, so it's not directly on the instance. It goes down to prototype chain to find those methods. So if we were to invoke them, JavaScript would be like, oh, well, I don't have the bark method on the instance. I'll go down the prototype chain, and then it finds it on Dr. Prototype. So as you can also imagine, the methods that all instances would have in common, we want to add to the prototype because this doesn't take up memory. If like bark and wagtail would be on the constructor, we would just have two identical like functions, but each on an instance. So this would all take up memory for no reason. We can get the prototype of a specific instance with __ proto. This is deprecated because it can be a bit dangerous because you can also modify the prototype that way and you should not do that. Or you can use object.getPrototype off and then the instance to get the prototype. Just something to remember.
All right, next one. Which of the following statements are true? So we have a dog class that in the constructor has a username and a wagtail function. And it also has a bark method on the class body. And then we have two instances. We have dog one and dog two. And yeah, it's up to you to see which ones would be strictly equal to each other. So the right statements are A, C, D, and E. So what we have here is we have the dog prototype, and then we have two instances. We have dog one and dog two. So first saying that dog one dot wagtail equals dog two dot wagtail, where we're like strictly equaling the returned value of wagtail, and that is just a string wagging tail. And strings are strictly equal to each other. However, when we compare the actual function to each other, then they're not equal because we have the function on the constructor. So they both point to different function objects in memory. And when strictly comparing objects, it's false. It's because we're comparing different references to different spots in memory. So that one's false. But in this case, it's also kind of stupid that we added it to the constructor because it's just a function. We should have added it to the prototype. But yeah, that's just what happens when you add it to the constructor. And comparing dog1.bark and dog2.bark, well, that is the same because they both point to the bark method on the dog prototype. So they both point to the same function object, so the same spot in memory. So that's true. Object get prototype of dog1 and dog2, that's also true. They both point to the same prototype. And dog1.constructor and dog2.constructor, that is just pointing to the constructor function on the prototype. And that actually gets called when we create a new instance. So when we say like new dog, actually that constructor function is called. But yeah, we're just comparing the same function object to each other, so the same spot in memory. So that one is true. But yeah, so in this case, don't add wagtail to your constructor. Doesn't make sense. It's not instance dependent. So it should have been on the prototype, just like bark. We can create generator functions with the little asterisk after the function keyword. And essentially what this does is a generator function returns an iterator. And this is a special type of object that contains methods like next, return, and throw, and it also has a state. And with this iterator, we can call the next method, which kind of just like changes the state to running, and then returns the value that gets yielded from the generator function. So in this case, we yield one. So whenever we call next, the value is one, and done is false, because there are still more values to be yielded within the generator function. So whenever we call it again, hello, yes, it changes back to running, and then it, you know, returns that value. But we have to explicitly invoke next to actually do that. Because with regular functions, you know, it's like kind of this all or nothing approach. Whenever we call a regular function, it will just execute that entire body. There's no way for us to kind of pause it in between. But with the generator function, we can. And it'll just keep doing this until we actually return from the generator function, either explicitly or implicitly, in which case done is true. Now the cool thing with, and then it's closed, with iterators is that, or with generator functions is that we can then, you know, create iterables. So we can use the spread operator on the iterator that gets returned from the generator function and use stuff like for off. And you can see that whenever we do that, only the yielded values get logged, so not their actual returned value. So this question is pretty much the same as this this example that I show here. But question 21 is what gets logged. So we have the generator function count that yields 1, 2, and then returns 3. And then we have a for off method that logs the value of the returned iterator object that gets returned from the count generator function. So with that log, either 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, promise, 3, 1, or 1, 2. The right answer here is 1 and 2, E. I'm just going to copy this and like show you what's going on in the console. All right, so we have this generator count function, but I'm going to set the iterable to count. So again, this doesn't, whenever we invoke count, we're not running any function or anything. Like unlike if we, you know, had like function count, this would execute the function. That's not the case with a generator function. So now you can see that it is suspended. That's kind of what I just try to show you. And then it has the prototype generator, and this contains next, return, and throw. And this gets used by methods that need an iterable, or that, you know,
iterate over iterable. So the const or for off or using the spread operator. So we can use like it, this is 1, 2, or you know, the const value of it. Well, actually, so if we do it again now, you can see that, or okay, let me just log this. And you can see that it's closed now. And that is because we, the like iterator itself, we've kind of like exhausted now. We've already, you know, yielded all the values, so now it's closed. Of course, what we can do is just create another one. So it too is count again. And this is fine. We can just iterate over iterable 2 again. That's fine, because like we just created a new object based on that generator function. But once it's closed, once we've already yielded all the values, we cannot reuse the same iterable.